Before we address the question of how to hedge and price an American contingent claim, let us have a closer look at the optimal stopping problem with which we were faced with in the definition of an optimal exercise strategy. And in a way, that section over here is independent of the financial mathematic context. That's why in the definition of a Snell envelope, I would like to consider a general filtered probability space omega FFTP, and the only assumption I would like to impose is that the index set I is given by the finite set 0 up to capital T. Moreover, I consider an adapter process denoted by X, and I would like to assume that XT is integrable for any time point T in my index set. And then I define recursively a new process denoted by ZT in the following way. I simply set Z capital T to be equal to X capital T, and ZT is then defined as a maximum of XT and the conditional expectation of ZT plus 1 given FT. And this so defined process Z is called the Snell envelope of the process X with respect to this underlying probability measure P. So why we emphasize this dependence on that probability measure? Well, due to the fact that T is defined in terms of a conditional expectation, and the conditional expectation clearly depends on the underlying probability measure, we include that reference in this definition. Moreover, you can observe that since the process X is an adapted process, we know that XT is FT measurable. Also, the conditional expectation is FT measurable. Hence, the maximum of two FT measurable random variables is also FT measurable, which clearly then shows that ZT is FT measurable, meaning that the process Z is indeed an adapted process. The only question we should address here is, why do we know that the conditional expectation appearing in the definition of the Snell envelope exists? And that's the first question I would like to address. Namely, given an adapted and integrable process X, the statement is the Snell envelope is well defined. And for that, we should convince ourselves that for any time point t from our index set, that t is simply an integrable random variable. Once we know that, then it is clear that the corresponding conditional expectation exists, which then shows that this Snell envelope is well defined. And the proof of this integrability of the process Z is done by an induction argument, but backward in time. So the base core of our induction argument is the terminal time point capital T. So we would like to have conclude that the expected value of the modulus of that capital T is finite, but this follows immediately from the integrability of the random variable X capital T due to the fact that by definition Z capital T is equal to X capital T. So what about the induction step? So let us assume by induction hypothesis that we already have shown that the random variables ZT plus 1 up to Z capital T are integrable. So in this induction step, we would like to focus now on the random variable ZT. So let's compute the expected value of the modulus of ZT. So by plugging in the definition of ZT and using the triangular inequality, we obtain the following upper bound on the expected value of the modulus of ZT, simply as the expected value of the maximum of the modulus of XT and the expected value or this conditional expectation of the modulus of ZT plus 1. Since ZT plus 1 is integrable, we also know that the conditional expectation of ZT plus 1 given FT exists. And by the monotonicity property of the condition expectation, we also know that the condition expectation is non-negative, as well as clearly this modulus of xt is non-negative. Hence, we can bound from above the maximum of these two non-negative random variables simply in terms of the sum of these two random variables. So hence, we obtain the following upper bound, namely the expected value of the modulus of xt and the expected value of the modulus of zt plus 1. But the process, or this random variable xt, is integrable, meaning that this expected value over here is finite. And by induction hypothesis, we know that the expected value of the modulus of zt plus 1 is finite. Hence, this proves that indeed the random variable zt is finite, and from that we can conclude that the Snell envelope is well defined. Let us come now to the most important properties of the Snell envelope. So for z, I give myself an adapted and integrable process x, and I denote the corresponding Snell envelope by z, and then it holds true that the Snell envelope is the smallest supermartingale which dominates the process x. And the second property is that the random variable tau star, which is defined, is the infimum over all time points t in the index set I, such that zt is equal to xt, is a stopping time. And not only that, but the stopped process, z tau star, is indeed a martingale. So let us have a look at the proof of part A. So clearly, zt dominates this process, this random variable xt, and this is due to the definition of zt. Namely, zt was defined as the maximum of xt and this conditional expectation of zt plus 1 given ft. And by dropping that conditional expectation, we obtain a lower bound, namely, which is given by xt. Pierre almost truly. Hence, the domination is a clear consequence of the definition of the Snell envelope. So let us have a look at the statement that the Snell envelope is a supermartingale. In order to convince ourselves about that fact, we have to check two things. First of all, integrability and the supermartingale property. But integrability is clear from the previous lemma, where we have shown that this random variable zt is integrable for any time point t. So what we are left with is checking whether the supermartingale property holds true. So for that purpose, let us fix any time point t in this index set 0 up to capital T minus 1. And again, by the definition of the random variable zt, which was defined in terms of the maximum of xt and the conditional expectation of zt plus 1 given ft. Now this time we drop the random variable xt and obtain the following lower bound, namely the conditional expectation of zt plus 1 given ft. And by using that almost sure inequality, we conclude for any time point s and t in our index set with s strictly less than t, that the conditional expectation of zt given fs, which we can write due to the tower property also as the conditional expectation given fs of the conditional expectation of ft given ft minus 1. Now we can use that property which we derived over here at time point between time point t and t minus 1 to obtain the following upper bound. We replace simply this conditional expectation by the random variable zt minus 1, and then we can repeat that argument until we end up with a random variable zs, which is then clearly fs measurable, and we can take that out. And in that way, we convinced ourselves that the supermartingale property for our Snell envelope holds true. What remains is to show that that is not only a super martingale, but this is the smallest super martingale which dominates X. So in order to show that, let us give ourselves a further super martingale Y, which has the property that Yt is larger or equal to Xtp almost surely for any time point. And we would like to conclude that then Yt has to be larger or equal to Ztp almost surely for any time point t in our index set. And again, this I would like to prove by an induction argument, but backward in time. So the base core of our induction argument at time point capital T is then the following. So by definition, we know that the process X capital T coincides with this random variable X capital T coincides with the random variable Z capital T. P almost surely. On the other hand, we know that the process Y dominates the process X, meaning that the random variable Y capital T is larger or equal than the random variable X capital T. And from that, we can immediately conclude that Y capital T is larger or equal than this random variable Z capital T. So let us now have a look at the induction step. So we assume that the random variables yt plus 1 up to y capital T dominates the corresponding variables, random variables zt plus 1 up to z capital T. And in the induction step, we would like to convince ourselves that this domination only also holds true at time point little t. So, and the argument goes as follows. First of all, by the fact that Y is a super martingale, we know that Yt is larger or equal than the conditional expectation of Yt plus 1 given Ft. And now using the induction hypothesis, which tells us that Yt plus 1 is larger or equal to Zt plus 1, it then follows from the monotonicity property of the conditional expectation that then also the conditional expectation of Yt plus 1 given Ft is larger or equal than the conditional expectation of Zt plus 1 given Ft, P almost surely. On the other hand, we know by assumption that Yt is larger or equal to Xtp almost surely. Hence, we can conclude that Yt is larger or equal than the maximum of Xt and the conditional expectation of Zt plus 1 given Ft. But this is nothing else but the definition of Zt. Hence, we convinced ourselves that indeed the Snell envelope is the smallest supermartingale which dominates X. Let us come now to the part B of the statement. So I would like to address first the question whether or not this random variable tau star defined in that way is a stopping time. Clearly, the tau star takes values which are bounded from above by capital T, because of the fact that by definition Z capital T is equal to X capital T. And in order to check that this random variable tau star is a stopping time, in view of this lemma 1.2, it suffices to prove that the event that the random variable tau star is equal to the time t is an Ft measurable event. And in order to do so, let us have first a look what happens at time point t equal to 0. So then we know by definition that tau star is equal to 0 is equal to the event that that 0 is equal to x0, but due to the fact that the process x and the process z are adapted processes, we know that this event over here is f0 measurable, which is, so to say, the desired statement at time point 0. So what about time points from one on? So then we can write the event that Torsten is equal to t simply. So what does it mean? So that's the first time point where the two processes coincide. So meaning for all time points from 0 up to t minus 1, we know that the process zt has to be different from the process xt. And due to the fact that we know that the process that, so our Snellenwelle dominates the process x, we can decompose that event in the following way. It's nothing else but the intersection from s from 0 to t minus 1 of the event that zs is strictly larger than xs, intersecting with the event that at the time point t, zt is equal to xt. But due to the fact that both processes z and x are adapted, we know that this event that zs is strictly larger than xs is fs measurable. And due to the fact that fs is taken from a filtration, we know that this sigma algebra fs is contained in the sigma algebra ft. On the other hand, we also know that the event that zt is equal to xt is ft measurable, and this then proves that indeed the event that Torsten is equal to t is ft measurable. Hence, we have convinced ourselves that Torsten is indeed stopping time. Let us now have a look at the statement that the stopped process zTorsten is a martingale. So first of all, by the optional stopping theorem, we know that zTorsten is a supermartingale because the underlying Snell envelope is as well a supermartingale. And now, in order to show that zTorsten, the stopped process, the stopped Snell envelope, for that particular choice of the stopping time is not only a supermartingale, but it's indeed a martingale. Let us have a look at the difference between the stop process at time point t plus 1 and the stopped process at time point t. So clearly, when Torsten is less than t, then here the minimum between t plus 1 and Torsten and t and Torsten is then equal to Torsten, and then these two processes simply cancel out because that Torsten minus that Torsten is 0. So we only have to consider the situation when Torsten is strictly larger than t. But in that situation, we know that this minimum between t and Torsten and t plus 1 and Torsten is the same as considering the Snell envelope at the time point t plus 1 and at time point t. So we are faced with having a look at this difference on the event that Torsten is strictly larger than t. So by plugging in the definition of zt, which is nothing else but the maximum of xt and the condition expectation, and by using the fact that on the event that Torsten is strictly larger than t, so meaning at time point t, we know that the process xt is strictly less than zt. Otherwise, Torsten would have occurred before time point t. So meaning that this condition expectation is larger than the random variable zt. Hence, this maximum is obtained at that condition expectation. So we end up with the following expressions, that the difference of the stop processes is equal to this indicator function that Torsten is larger than t times the difference between zTorsten and t plus 1 minus the condition expectation of zt plus 1 given ft. And that decomposition and that observation is crucial in the proof of the martingale property. Why? Well, now let us have a look at the condition expectation of the stop process at time point t plus 1 and time point t given the sigma algebra ft. So by plugging in this result over here, we end up with the conditional expectation of the indicator function times this difference between this Snell envelope at time point t plus 1 and the conditional expectation of the Snell envelope at time point t plus 1 given ft. And we have seen that this random variable tau star is a stopping time, meaning that the event that tau star is less than or equal to t is contained in the sigma algebra ft, but this is nothing else but the complement of this event that tau star is less than or equal to t, meaning also that that event over here is contained in the sigma algebra ft. Hence, this indicator function of this event is ft measurable, so we can take that measurable factor out from the conditional expectation. And now we end up with the conditional expectation of this difference over here given ft, but now by using simply linearity and the fact that this random variable is ft measurable by definition, we see that this difference is equal to 0p almost surely, and this is the desired martingale property for the stopped martingale. And this then concludes the proof. So let us here now define what we mean by an optimal stopping time. So stopping time tau taken from our set of all stopping times which are bounded from above by capital T is called optimal for a given process X and the underlying reference measure P if the following holds true, namely that the expected value of the stopped process x tau star is equal to the supremum over all possible or admissible stopping times of the corresponding expected value of the stopped process x tau. So what I would like to convince you is now the following, that the random variable tau star, which we have seen already in the last theorem, is indeed an optimal stopping time. And not only that, we also can say something about the value of the expected of the stop process when we take expectations. But step by step. So I give myself again an adapted and integrable process X. I denote by that the corresponding Snell envelope, and I define this stopping time tau star again as the infimum over all time points t in my index head, such that this process zt is equal to xt. And then the statement is the following: this stopping time is an optimal stopping time, and it also holds true that the expected value of x tau star is equal to the initial value or the expected value of the initial value of our Snell envelope. So we can characterize that expected value in terms of the expected value of the corresponding Snell envelope. And this is somehow also a tool how to compute or how to evaluate or compute that expected value over here. So how to prove that theorem? So first of all, by the previous theorem, we know that this stopped Snell envelope is a martingale. So what does it mean? So this simply means the following thing. First of all, by definition of the stopping time tau star, we know that the expected value of that tau star, or this random variable z tau star, is equal to x tau star, meaning also the expected value of this random variable x tau star is equal to the expected value of z tau star. Now, let us take advantage of the fact that this random or the stopping time tau stars bounded from above by capital T. Hence, I can write that stop process also in the following way. That's the expected value of that of the minimum between capital T and tau star. So here's a typo. But once I have done that, written in this process in that form, and I can now use simply the definition of the conditional expectation to write that expected value also as the expected value of that capital T minimum tau star given F0. And using now the fact that the stop process is is a martingale, we then conclude that this expected value over here is equal to the random variable Z0 minimum tau star, which is nothing else but the random variable Z0, meaning we end up with the expected value of Z0, which shows, first of all, that the expected value of X tau star is equal to the expected value of Z0. On the other hand, we know for any stopping time, and the fact that the Snell envelope is a supermartingale, that the following holds true by the optional stopping theorem. Namely, we already have seen that the expected value of that zero can be written as the expected value of that zero minimum tau, which we can also write by using the supermartingale property of the Snell envelope and also of this stopped Snell envelope using the optimal stopping theorem as the expected value of the conditional expectation of that capital T minimum tau given F0. But what we have seen over here by using the definition of the conditional expectation is nothing else but the expected value of that capital T minimum tau. And now we take advantage of the fact that tau is chosen from that set, meaning that tau is bounded from above by capital T, that this minimum between capital T and tau is nothing else but so that's just random variable tau. And by using the fact that the Snell envelope dominates my underlying process Mx, I obtain then the following lower bound, namely that I can replace that expected value of that tau by the expected value of x tau. So what I have obtained here, well, this what I have proved here holds true for any tau taken from that set of stopping times which are bounded from above by t, meaning I can also, since I have that inequality, I can also perform on that side it takes a supremum over all stopping times tau. And then I obtain the following lower bound, namely that the expected value of Z0 is larger or equal than the supremum over all stopping times tau taken from that set of admissible stopping times of this expected value of the stop process X tau. But since this stopping time tau star is contained in that set, we not only get an inequality, but we get indeed an inequality. And then by using this first part, I can replace this value Z of the expected value of Z of zero by the expected value of Z of tau star, which then shows that indeed that stopping time tau star is an optimal stopping time.